So actually, I don't have much focus about this paper, so, but because the title of the session is Does Management Matter? So I try to talk about management training experiments, which I have conducted recently. But before that, I'd like to say this. I have conducted about 25 case studies of industrial development of different industries in different countries, including the East Asia, South Asia, and also Sub-Saharan Africa, including leather shoe industry in Ethiopia, metalwork industry in Kumasi, Ghana, Nairobi, Kenya, and Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, and the garment sector in Dar es Salaam. And then the development path is, you know, different in different industries, in different countries, but they could be put into three groups. This is a typical type in many developing countries. So somehow the some guy, entrepreneur, started the production of imitation of imported products. And then initially, it is difficult to get the appropriate material, and it is difficult to find the customers. If the pioneer overcomes those difficulties, then the profitability is relatively high, because although the quality of product is very low, but still there are a lot of consumers who are happy to buy the product at a low price compared with the imported product. And then initially no competitors, so profitability is high. But looking at the high profit of the pioneer, there are apprentices, workers, or neighbors, we start imitating the business. And then cluster is formed. And then the traders come to pick up the products or delivered materials. So business becomes easier. So the number of producers in this sector increase. Then gradually the market is saturated, because it's not exportable quality. So then the profitability will decline. So as the number of producers increase, and then the profitability becomes eventually zero, and then no more new entry. This is the first type. The second type is like this V-shaped development path. So the producers recognize the decline in profitability, and then they try to improve the quality of products, but then they have to distinguish their products from the inferior quality products. So that's why they try to establish brand name, but brand name may be stolen. So they need to develop their own distribution network, marketing strategies. And then if it is successful, then the business expands rapidly, but then they need management on those things. So they have to learn a lot of new things. And maybe learning from abroad is very important. And then third type is this one, green one. So from the beginning, the industry has high productivity, maybe because they started with sufficient knowledge or managerial and technological capabilities. And then they tend to be an exporting industry. So market is very large. So although the number of producers increased, but no saturation. So then steady growth can be observed. So I have some examples, starting with the last one, dynamically growing industry. This example is coming from Bangladesh, the garment industry. So it started in 1979 or 1980 with intensive training of about 130 educated young people from Bangladesh. They received a very good training for 8 months, 7 or 8 months in South Korea, and then came back and started production of garment, and then successfully exported through the Korean firms export network. And then they stopped the contract with South Korean companies, technical corporation contract, and then the workers, trainees themselves, started their business. either the factories or trading houses. And then, like a continuation of cell divisions, they increased in number. So the, right now, they have, there are more than 5,000 big farms, export-oriented, 100% export-oriented, and they employ 3.6 million workers. And then average size of factories, 700 workers. Some factories have several thousand workers, like this. So and this green line is the number of workers per farm. Blue columns are number of farms, and the red one is the number of workers, 3.6 million. And then this is an example of the V-shaped one from China. The industry started in late 1970s by a teenage farmer, and he started produce from the piece of used metal, a kind of a repair parts for fuse or other switches, other electric fitting things, and then the, it was very profitable, so the neighbors started to imitate. And then the number of producers increased, and then profitability declined. But the market itself was began growing very rapidly because of the construction boom in China. But possible producers were everywhere in China. But they just started from the small houses. So the similar producers are everywhere in China, but somehow, this Wenzhou, one township in Wenzhou City was very successful because they improved the quality. And then they could have a very high share of the domestic, growing, rapidly growing domestic market. That's why they grew very rapidly, extremely rapidly in the 1990s. First 5 years, let's look at this. Not this one. So sales revenue value added became 3 times, and then next 5 years, 10 times, and the employment grow double, and then 3 times. So very rapid growth, but even faster than the Bangladesh garment industry. Very successful. This is a picture of the top largest companies in around 2002 or 2003. So. And then this is the same industry. This is a number of workers, 30 workers, 300 workers, 3,000 workers, and then value added divided by number of workers. This is a monthly. So $1,000 per month per worker in 1990. Then 10 years later, the distribution shifted. Right, so there are, and then these top, very successful one, introduced a lot of new things. So brand name and higher quality product, brand name, and their own distribution network. And they have a very nice management. Although the pioneers are just elementary school graduates, but at some point, they began hiring, poaching the highly educated managers from the state-owned enterprises. And state-owned enterprises had a lot of, decent people who have the technology and managerial knowledge, but they were not functioning in state enterprises because of the lack of incentive. But they shifted to private sector, they're very active. And so, and then later on, then some of these firms began hiring MBA holders or even the PhD holders. So that's why the productivity very high and then growing very rapidly compared with others. But now I talk about stagnant ones, so zero profit ones, survival clusters. So from Vietnam, even in East Asia, there are such stagnant clusters. And then in this case, okay, look at this very high value added per worker per month compared with the Wenzhou, even higher. but they are very small. The reason why is they're very random. So variation is very huge. Variance is very large. They are always faced with a lot of the, you know, negative shocks. And they cannot control. So sometimes even value added is negative. Not the profit. Value added is negative. So they purchased a lot of materials and they couldn't sell the product. So that kind of thing happened very often. This is a cross section, but if we look at if we trace one farm over time, and then sometimes very high, sometimes very low, because of that variation, so there are a lot of risk and also a lot of inventory cost and other costs. And considering that, they have to confine themselves with a very small size. Okay. Then please look at this picture. This is one of the producer of the knitwear of the same industry in Vietnam. So in this house, there are 12 workers are working, plus this manager. And this manager began searching scissor. And then I observed him. Then he continued search scissor and then for about 20 minutes. And then please look at this chaotic workshop. So the efficiency is very, very low. So observing that, I thought that, okay, in the case of this kind of industry everywhere, not only in Africa, but even in East Asia, of course in the South Asia. But and in the case of Sub-Saharan Africa, there are a lot of problems, including infrastructure problem and you know, governance and those things. But there would be a lot of things which the firms, enterprises themselves can improve. One of the points is the management. Of course, they need more technology, but even if the production function shifted up, but they cannot manage well, then they cannot expand the business. Then the benefit from the new technology will be very small. So first thing should be done. Yeah. First thing is improvement of management. And then after that, a lot of adoption of new technology. Then I conducted, to show that, I conducted, my team conducted several management training experiments in Ghana, Kenya, Ethiopia three times, or three different industries, Tanzania and Vietnam, two places, in collaboration with the World Bank and the JICA, so John Page and Hin are my sponsors and bosses, and then also Shimada-san from JICA is my sponsor and boss. And then sometimes we succeeded in the randomize, and sometimes failed to randomize for many reasons. And then a unique feature of experiments is focus on the stagnant industries, because dynamically growing ones already have some kind of basis to absorb, basis for learning from abroad. And also the V-shaped one already have, you know, acquiring that kind of, you know ability. But I want to show that even the, you know, stagnant one can start growing if they get a, you know, basic knowledge of management. Or not, maybe not all, but some of them will be start picking up. So that's the point of purpose of the experiment. And also, already, you know, the literature, already many experiments of the management training has been done. But then most of them are about a microfinance client, a very small enterprise, self-employed. But ours are a little bit larger enterprises. And also, the existing studies, most experiment, mostly focus on the bookkeeping and business planning or marketing. But we also include the production management, quality control. Because I'm a Japanese, I like to emphasize it, Kaizen. And but Americans may call it lean manufacturing management. And also, because we did case studies before, so our training design is based on baseline studies. And then major findings. This is a findings. These are the findings common to the other researchers' experiments. So participants in the training program are very happy to learn about basic management practices. And then we found that many entrepreneurs, participants, do not know even very simple management knowledge, including the bookkeeping and the importance of talking to their own workers. So when we started the Kaizen training, so maybe the first action would be, okay, let's clean up the workshop. Then in order to start the cleaning up, the entrepreneur have to talk to their workers. Okay, I decided to introduce Kaizen to our workshop, so let's clean up. Then the owner recognized, oh, I haven't talked to my workers for 3 months, like that. So then the workers are very happy because the communication starts. So in this sense, so Kaizen is a very human-friendly approach. Oh, just 5 minutes. Okay, so let me ask. Majority of participants try to put knowledge into practice. And then somewhat new finding is that we asked before and after training the willingness to pay for this kind of training. And then initially, willingness to pay is very low. But after training, it significantly increased. That means many of them don't know the value of learning or management, about management. And then so many other researchers already pointed out that this kind of training may improve the business practice, management practices, but seldom lead to an increase in the profitability or sales or value added. Yeah, I agree. So even a case, there are cases in which we couldn't find a significant impact. But according to some studies, like Bloom, they spent a huge amount of money in India and just trained 17 farms or something, 70 plants. They spent 2 years and then $1 million or something. And then the impact was huge, according to them. But JICA did a large scale one in Ethiopia too. And then, because the treatment group was selected by the late Prime Minister Meles, so we couldn't randomize at all. But because Meles selected the largest farms, so we couldn't find a comparable group, but tried to get a large one, but still, the treatment group is much larger. But still, please compare before and after. This group grew a lot compared with this. So, and even in the proportion, the T statistics are very, very high. Okay, so if we spend a lot of money and a lot of energy, time, and then we are sure that we can improve. But problem is whether or not we can improve those small enterprises with small budget and shorter time. But our training experiment said, okay, when we find a statistically significant impact on those financial performance, then the economic sense magnitude is huge. So we don't need to calculate the cost-benefit. It's so obvious. So benefit exceeds the cost. But of course, the impact depends much on the design of the training. And then this thing is not yet studied. So we don't know what kind of training is good for what type of people. So if we design very well, then the impact will be very strong. So this is Ghana, Kumasi training. They are entrepreneurs. Cost benefit. And then also, one of our new findings is that spillover, very strong knowledge spillover from the participant to non-participant. But interesting thing is that spillover is not about stealing information, but it's giving information. The reason is those participants who found the training is very useful, then they're excited, then they cannot stop talking about the training. So so we have some, you know, primitive, but we have very significant results. It suggests that spillover will take place in this way, just 2 minutes. Okay, this is the last slide. But of course, there are many things to be studied in the future. So for example, many researchers, including ourselves, just tried to evaluate the impact, maybe almost 1 year after the training program. So long-run impact has not been evaluated yet. And then what should be taught, in what manner, not yet studied. And then, of course, the existence of spillover means that social benefit exceeds the private benefit. So there are kind of justification for policy intervention. But of course, even if the spillover is very important, still, the problem is that we cannot provide training to everybody because there are a huge number of small enterprises in Africa. But I think we don't have to do so because, for example, media campaign. Now, the Ethiopia, the government is very serious about the spreading the Kaizen throughout the country. And they established this government organization. This is the first government body with Kaizen in the name, in the world. Even in Japan, we don't have this kind of name. And then now Tanzania is following. And then in Zambia, Kenya, Ghana, and Egypt are also very much interested in the diffusion of Kaizen. And then Ethiopia Kaizen Institute now purchased 20 minutes for FM radio program every week. So they talk about Kaizen. So this guy introduced Kaizen and so successful, something like that. Maybe if they use the TV program, that would, you know, impact would be stronger. So that kind of thing will be important. And of course, we will train the trainers. And eventually, those trainers will do business of the training. On the kind of the market mechanism business. So we should evaluate the how efficiently we can train the traders and those things. So these things have not been studied at all. So thank you very much. So this is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.